If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Right then, so now we reach part three, where I'm actually going to build and put together the actual test bed. Now this is a little scary for me because I've got a fair bit of clearing up to do. I'm kind of going to show you before and afters, after I've given you a few more details. It's messy at the moment. I need to pull everything apart so it's clear, and then put the new 2x2 mirror setup in place. I then need to start switching on lights and seeing if I can calibrate things. I know obviously I can produce the power output from both of those panels because the 500 watt LED is so powerful, but I now need to get a balance between the UV and the infrared with that 500 watt LED. So hence, and I kind of didn't go into detail in the first video as to why I was adopting this 800 watts or 850 watts per square meter. The reason is that the UV lights and the infrared lights that I've got at the moment will struggle to put out the matching power relative to the amount of visible spectrum that I can put out with that LED. So by dropping the level to a more real world level, which is what you'd see outside on average, somewhere between 800 and 850 rather than 1000, those are going to be more real world figures. By dropping that level, that means that relative to that, I've got more chance of having enough, in particular infrared. Again, if you looked at that graph, although the amorphous panels certainly have a little more benefit of the UV part of the spectrum, there's not too big of a difference between the amorphous panels and traditional panels in the amount of UV that they're taking advantage of that, or that's there. But on the infrared side, that's certainly different. Traditional panels are making more use of that infrared and less of the visible part of the spectrum. So I need enough infrared to make traditional panels work balanced with the visible part of the spectrum and then some UV. So that's going to be the tricky balancing act for me. So I'm going to do a little bit of freehand. I'm going to show you the mess I've got at the moment, and then what I'm going to put together, and then I'll come back for an after shot with it all together and when I start calibrating. Now, so before we have a look, because I've got this tucked under the bench, if you looked at my previous video, you'll know that I was using this mirror. I shine the light in here. This has got mirrored sides in here, and of course that helps a huge amount with amplifying the amount of light which hits the solar panel. So you've got a certain amount of light which is coming in. If I didn't have these mirrored sides, a lot of that light is lost. You're only kind of getting direct light. By having mirrored sides, I'm not losing that light. It's being bounced back inside so that I'm not reliant all on the power of the single spot. And it also diffuses the light a bit, right? So as I have these lights around the side with it bouncing around and mixing, I've got less of a kind of spot, less. Otherwise, I'm going to have a really, I'm not going to have good uniformity. I know that's going to be a potential issue, but by bouncing the light around inside, potentially I get a bit more uniformity around the entire test area and a mix of the light. Now, this 1 foot square mirror, you can see is fairly stiff because it's not that big. When we go to the 2 foot item, you'll see that because it's now 2 feet and the same thickness as this, it gets more flexible. When I set it up initially, I had tape. You can see I'm just using Gorilla tape to hold this together. This was perfectly fine and strong enough. I wasn't hanging as many lights off it as well. So this held nice and sturdy. The other complication is the way I'm suspending it. I was suspending it at an angle. I had these ropes coming up which allowed me to change the height. They're at an angle pulling in, But on this being stiff, it wasn't an issue. But on that 2 foot one, it started to collapse the sides in. There was just too much weight. They were further out, there was more stress on them, and the Gorilla Tape was peeling off. So I'll show you what I did to fix that. Right then, so excuse the free hand, but this is the 2 foot by 2 foot setup. You can see nice mirrors in here, kind of, you have an infinity effect if you have something sat in here. What I went and done, as opposed to Gorilla Tape, I got this aluminium angle and I drilled through and mounted bolts to hold this together, right? So I've got a nice place to suspend this by. It makes the corners nice and secure. One small mishap, and I was expecting actually more of this. You can see that crack there. I thought I was gonna get bad cracking on all of these when I drilled through. But basically, mainly just that one point there, that's certainly not going to play any role at all, so I'm not worried about that. And then the other thing I've got, as opposed to suspending this at an angle, still placing strain, because these sides, you can see these are far more wobbly compared to the others, because it's the same thickness but over a longer length. Oh my goodness, isn't that an interesting effect? You could almost do a disappearing act. You can see my floor, so you could potentially do an illusion where you're kind of hiding something behind it. Because there's a fair bit of flex in this, I don't want the strings coming up at an angle. I've got this angle iron with holes in it, which will mean the strings are coming straight down. So the strings will come straight down to support this, which should make it a bit more of a rugged solution. So let me just show you the test area. Right, so the test area looks a shambles, right? And that's because I pulled everything, I pulled the mirrored square out and I just disconnected everything and laid it down. But this is a part of the problem with doing this testing, is when I'm kind of plugging lights in and out and connecting them, wiring becomes messy. Nothing dangerous, it's just messy. I've got nice leads running up here for the lights. This is the main 500 watts LED with its power supply up there. I can adjust the intensity by adjusting either the current or the voltage to it. I generally adjust the current to it to give me some control. And then I've got various lights to give me infrared. This is an infrared heat lamp. I've got a halogen lamp. I've got a more traditional incandescent lights. All of these kick out a nice amount of infrared, and I need to see whether these are going to be enough. I then have some CFL lights, which give a nice spread of light. Unlike an LED, which is point focused, these spread the light, and between these and this LED light over here, these operate at different parts of the spectrum. They're slightly apart, which I like, so it balances out where the UV is in my setup. So I'm gonna pull this all apart and connect it up together. I've got the device so I can measure the light intensity in watts per square meter. That's I can use as a guide. And then obviously I start measuring the power. And for that, I start using the solar module analyzer to measure the power output. Now, obviously, the biggest challenge I have with this whole setup is, for one, the consistency. We're going to see whether these lights remain fairly consistent. So you've got consistent power output. The one biggest effect is heat. These lamps, particularly the infrared, are going to heat up the solar panel. So I need cooling, and what I've found works well, you can see underneath, I've shown this before, I've got a big car or vehicle radiator fan underneath, and this drives a lot of air. And when you've got the enclosure, the nice thing is it sucks air. So I'm basically sucking air down through the top of that and pulling it out the bottom of this little this is a cake cooling or drying rack I've got here, and I've got little legs for it, so it is raised up, the air gets sucked out, and I can, by varying the speed of that, I can control the temperature of the solar panels and the whole test setup. So I'll use that along with adjusting the lights to get the right power level, and then it's a case of balancing the different solar panel technologies, the amorphous versus the more traditional solar panels, to see if we can try and get the same power output that I get outside. Right, I'll see you later. Right then, so it is a day later. I probably spent another 3 or 4 hours yesterday setting up the test bed and playing around with the lights, doing calibrations so that I could get 3 solar panels or 3 cells to provide the same readings that I got outside. So we're going to be testing the SunPower cell, the generic monocrystalline cell, which looks like this, except it doesn't have the SunPower cells, and then the amorphous cell. And that, if I can get it within roughly about a tenth of a watt. So a tenth of a watt for the range of rated power for these cells ranges somewhere between 5% and 2.5% or 2% in terms of the margin or error margin that I'm playing with. If I can get that, I'll be happy. I mean, it's not a very scientifically set up test bed. It's Heath Robinson, it's Rube Goldberg kind of setup. It is a prototype test area. I know of companies, I remember when I first showed my first solar simulator, I had a company contact me and they were interested in talking because they were testing their own panels. And they explained, they wouldn't give all the details. They're very cagey about their setup. People tend, because these devices cost so much money. I think I've mentioned this before. If you want to measure 2 inches by 2 inches, or it might be 20 millimeters by 20 millimeters, you're going to pay tens of thousands of dollars for a proper solar simulator to get a proper uniform spread of light across that area and a good spread of the spectrum. As soon as you start stepping up to bigger measurement areas, and certainly if you were going 2 foot by 2 foot, you pay hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I certainly haven't paid this. It hasn't been cheap setting this up. I thumb sucked that with the cost of that 500 watts LED and the power supply to drive it and auxiliary lighting or what have you, it's around $900 to $1,000. Just for a simple DIY, but $1,000 versus a couple of $100,000, there's a big difference. So the big test is, I've got, during my setup, I've got this all working, but I've powered it all down now because it makes a racket. What I'm going to do is power it back up, and the first test is, can I replicate my last result? So I've got the generic monocrystalline cell on there. It needs to produce about 1.7 watts. I'm going to put an insert here of the spreadsheet of the test conditions and the results that I got the day before yesterday. You'll see that I had ambient temperatures of around 20 to 21 degrees Celsius, which just happened to be perfect for kind of normal test conditions. I allowed the cells to reach their normal operating temperature, and again, remember this ranges, and I've got literally within those ranges here. That's what I was hoping for, but it requires the fan being on full tilt. I'm going to show you how when I first switch things on, we'll look at the voltage. There's two ways of doing it. We can measure the temperature and look at the voltage of the cell as it slowly starts dropping as it starts heating up. We can actually monitor that. I can set the brightness or the light intensity level with a setting on the power supply, and I've got a multimeter monitoring that, and then we'll switch through the cells. And then at the end, what I'm going to do as an interesting test, which I haven't done yet, is I'm going to switch off all the auxiliary lights, and I'll explain when we get to the build what I've done with those as well, and just use the LED, power up the one of the monocrystallines, probably the SunPower, to its full STC rating of about 3.5 watts. And then we're going to put the amorphous cell under at that same setting and see what that puts out. And that might give us some idea of how it, what it takes to balance these lights. But sorry, I digressed. Going back to that company who had the test set up, I asked them, what do you do? Are you able to test both monocrystalline, polycrystalline, and amorphous? And they said, well, when we test amorphous, we recalibrate the system. So it just shows you some of the challenges. It's very difficult to cater for both, and I think I've got a balance which does that, but let's take a look. Right then, so a quick bit of freehand just to show you the test setup. I've got this solar module analyzer here, so this is what I do the measurements on. And just out of interest, I'll bring you up and you can see the last measurement I did, which is still there, is showing 1.722 watts. And that is the normal generic monocrystalline cell, which is there. Underneath it, I've got the amorphous. So I don't disturb things. There's only a few millimeters difference in height. The height does make it, you only need to make small adjustments before you start messing things up. The intensity obviously changes as you get closer to this LED. But there's only a few mil, and what I do is at the moment I'm putting these cells on top of the amorphous one, and then I can remove them and take measurements on the amorphous one to see get the balance right. So this is the setup. I use these angle iron over here, which give a far better support. There's no stress on it, so it all stays in place. A nice big work area. I actually ended up removing two of the UV lights and two of the infrared lights because I found that I actually didn't need them. Initially, I was worried when at the first setup, I wasn't getting enough power out of the monocrystallines, and I was worried I didn't have enough infrared. So then I jacked up the LED light. I then overpowered them, and I found that after I'd made adjustments for the amorphous cell with the UV light, I didn't need those other lights. So I'm down to literally this heat lamp providing infrared, the halogen providing infrared over there, and this UV light. Now, of course, again, this is an approximation. If I put my spectrometer under here, you're going to find a very peaky side of the UV end. But the UV side doesn't make a huge difference. It certainly does change the measurement. If I switch this off and switch it on, I can see the difference on the amorphous panel. But I say all I'm trying to do is just balance things out, get an approximation so that I can use different solar power, different solar cell technologies on here, and get just about the same reading that I would outdoors. Right, so I'm going to put this on a tripod. I'm going to power it up, and I might annotate if I cannot speak over the fan noise, and I'll show you what happens with the temperature and other parameters. Oh, just before I do that, so up here I've got a multimeter, which I'll switch on now. And this will measure the voltage which is being supplied by this Meanwell LED driver. This is a 600 watts LED driver, and I can adjust the voltage, current limiting, and the voltage. The voltage I've actually got almost set down low. I'm just adjusting the current limit to change the voltage level if I need to make adjustments to the intensity of the light coming out of the LED. Okay, I'm going to put you here just to give myself a bit of space to work as I fire everything up, and then again I'll probably go freehand. I may have to annotate depending on the noise levels. First thing is the fan for the 500 watt LED. You have to switch that on first to make sure that doesn't overheat, and then we can power everything else up. So once that's on, we can then do bang, that's the LED, infrared, UVs go on. You can see I can monitor the voltage level here. That's the one thing, is to see if I can get consistent levels when I fire everything up again. This should be 34.9. Oh, there we go, it is dropping down. It was at 35, it is coming down, so obviously it's settling. Let me show you something quickly. So at the moment, I haven't put the main fan on, which will allow me to talk to you. And what I want you to see is the open circuit voltage of the solar panel, how that is dropping off quite dramatically, right? Because it's heating up. So that would be power loss ultimately if it was all connected up. Now I'm going to switch the fan on. Okay, I'm not sure if you can hear me, but that'll keep some control on that level. So now we'll let it settle. We'll do some temperature measurements.
So it's still cool. It still needs to get to about 50.
Right then, so this little video insert is about 2 or 3 days after filming this part three. It's in fact about 10 o'clock at night. I've come because I'm trying to get this video out. And I noted something interesting, which I didn't properly explain in the video, as to why there was such a difference between these two panels, right? I was expecting to get 2.2 watts out of this. It was only getting 1.8. So why? How did that happen? Now, the previous day, what I'd done, I started off by calibrating with the amorphous panel first. I got that done. I then put the sun power cell underneath. I then got that right. I then double checked against the amorphous because that was my biggest challenge, right? I knew that these technologies in theory are the same. They're both crystalline silicon panels. So I got that balance right where they were both achieving what they should do outdoors. So I was getting the infrared balance with the UV for the amorphous one. And then I put this one, it was the end of the day. Again, I was rushing. I saw it wasn't quite right. So I made an adjustment for this. I thought, okay, I've made a change. I better go check the amorphous because that's the one that's going to really be affected. I went back and I adjusted things for the amorphous. And of course, I come in the next day. The amorphous result is correct. This result, which I did at the end of the day, was correct. But this one wasn't. So why? So in theory, if I've got it working for this one, why not for this? And this confirms something I noted just before we left Ohio when I was finishing off my testing underneath the previous grow light. I had another sun power panel at that point in time, and I noted that it was yielding different results to both a standard monocrystalline and polycrystalline panel. I could simulate the results under the grow light versus outside for a monocrystalline and a polycrystalline, but a sun power monocrystalline was yielding different results. And obviously the only logical conclusion to that is that this has got a different spectral response. So I suspect that sun power are doping this slightly differently. And in fact, just recently in some of my spectral response tests, when I was testing on this, I saw that it was behaving differently to this panel. So I'm hoping to get that meter done to actually confirm that, but that is what happened. So anyway, so that we don't have too much video, because I ended up with like almost an hour and a half of video. I'll edit it out and just show you. I spent another hour and a half adjusting across all three of the panels. So this became more challenging. Where I thought I was going to be kind of catering mainly for two types of technologies, I was now catering for three. And I've got them fairly close. You'll see the results. And then at the end of the video, I do a test where I show what happens when I adjust for, let's say, the maximum power output out of this panel under just the visual part of the spectrum from the white LED, if you will, running at full power, but then see the result of the amorphous power. And that will certainly show you the difference in the spectral response between the two, considering that the amorphous panel outside was putting out a fair bit less, 1.5 versus 2.2 for this one, but see what it does in the end result. But let's get back to the video. Righty-ho. So I hope you found that interesting. I'm very happy with those results. It is very easy to get tripped up. I said took 2 days of measurements because I knew initially I had an issue with the sonar analyzer. I hadn't set up some of the settings correctly, so some of the readings weren't correct. There's a balancing act when you've, even though you've got the panels outside across a plane and they're all at the same angle, does potentially one at one side versus another side get different readings? If you switch them around, would they change? Something like the dark brown cabin being closer to one side, that can affect reflected light. So I was having to be wary of all those kinds of things when I was setting up to do this. So I've been happy that I've been able to get these results indoors under this little test setup within roughly 0.1 watt of what I was getting outside. And again, the challenge is that I strongly suspect, and I think this will come out when I start doing the video on the spectral testing of the solar panels, is that these, where you'd think these are both monochrome solar panels, they doped in the same way and they should have the same spectral response, I've got a feeling that the sun power ones are slightly different. And that may account for their performance gain. It's probably something then that they're not openly advertising, but I say I've seen this before, but I'm hoping to confirm that. But anyway, I hope you found, if you managed to get to the end of part three, I do plan to do some further testing where I'm keen to see what happens with the angle of incidence of a solar panel as the sun's going down, when you get the different types of radiation potentially bouncing off the glass, your infrared versus your UV. So that is a test I'll do in the future. And again, my test setup, it's an approximation of what's going outside. I just wanted something inside where I could do some relative testing between panels, which is more consistent because outside conditions are changing all the time. I do face a challenge that for that small test area, that works well because all the lights are focused there. But even though I've got this larger space, I know once I start testing larger solar panels, I'm going to be first faced with a different challenge, because now they're going to be potentially outside of the focal point of those lights. So it's not perfect, but I think it'll suit my needs anyway. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.